Hi, this is Mike Hendrickson from OSCON 2013 in Portland, Oregon. I'm here with Tom Preston Werner. Tom, how you doing?
I'm doing great.
So you gave a talk this morning. You're with GitHub. You're
That's
the CEO
correct.
And founder of GitHub.
That's correct.
Right. And you've done a few other things in your background. Can you give everyone just a little taste of what you've done with open source in your career and where you've come from?
Yeah. So I've worked on a bunch of open source repositories, a bunch of open source projects. Jekyll is one of them. It's a static site converter for web logs and just for simple static pages. It's part of GitHub Pages. I wrote a process monitoring framework called God, because it watches over the demons. And I've been involved in open source for many years.
And Golem?
Golem is the wiki that powers GitHub itself, that O'Reilly actually
used at one point
to do some workflow stuff. And so I worked for myself for many years, just doing consulting. Got into Ruby on Rails development, ended up in San Francisco, and started GitHub as a side project.
So let me just ask, though, what led the thinking to GitHub? I mean, you were an open source guy, you built some tools, and you've done some things. What all of a sudden just dawned on you that we needed GitHub?
Well, it was really hard to share code online, and even within companies. It was just hard to watch what was going on, to get notified when things happened, to know where the code was, to have it in a fine-grained enough way that you didn't feel like you were going to screw up the whole Subversion-like tree, because Subversion, everything would be in one giant directory, essentially. Adding a new project to that was daunting. Like, you felt like you were going to screw it up every time. And Git started to come about. This was in 2007. Git started to get a little bit of attention, especially in the Ruby community where I was. It had a really great branching model. You could work with it offline. Everybody had a full history, so it was distributed, and which meant it was automatically backed up. Very hard to lose code. And you could experiment on your own computer. Create a branch, experiment. Nobody else had to even know what you were doing. This is really attractive to us, coming from a centralized, subversion-based world, having all of these new freedoms. And so we thought that was really cool, but there was no way to really share that code online with people. Which is ironic, because that was kind of the whole point, that it was easy to share and distribute to people, and yet it was very difficult. So we wanted to create a place where developers could share their code with Git.
So the open source community has always been about sharing, giving back, and using each other's code, but there wasn't a real great mechanism for doing that.
Yeah, well, everything was based on a centralized model. Subversion was used heavily in the open source world. And it was overly locked down, we think. In order to contribute, you had to get a copy of the software on your local machine, make some changes, and submit a patch file, like in, you know, a text version of some changes. The problem being that now you're going through a mailing list, you have to have these massive long conversations over email. They're hard to pull back up. They're hard for people to see in the future. You have to go through some big archive of stuff. Like, it just was not very interactive. And so we thought we could make it easier and make it so that it was based on Git, which meant that merging later would be a lot easier. Because with Git, you share, or you keep track of the history of where a branch came off. And so merging can use a three-way merge algorithm instead of a two-way that Subversion used, meaning less work had to be done after some code changes were proposed to merge that code into the final master version.
So something that came up in another talk this morning, which I found was interesting, your GitHub profile, that can become more cred for you than your LinkedIn profile or another profile.
Absolutely. Yeah. If you're a developer, people want to see what you're about.
What you've
and
done.
And if you are a developer, then that's your code. And so it becomes a kind of a living resume or a portfolio.
It's more like a portfolio for
developers, where if you're a designer, you know, you're probably, it's going to be hard to get hired if you don't have some examples of your design work. Well, as a developer, it's also to get hired if you don't have examples of your code work. And we wanted that to be a use that GitHub served as well. And so when we first did it, we came up with the idea of namespacing your work based on your username. So there wasn't one global namespace that was shared by all projects, which is how SourceForge did it, right? But that made that everyone was fighting for the best names. On GitHub, you have your own username, and all of your code and all of your work lives within that namespace, which gives you much more freedom to put up anything you want without having to worry about polluting this global namespace. And it makes it so that you have a showcase for whatever code you're working on, whatever you write, for future employers, for yourself. 3 years from now, when you wrote that piece of code, but you never put it anywhere, and now you really wish you had it back, well, now that's what GitHub is for.
Yep. So you gave a great talk this morning, and you had some principles you were talking about. For those who couldn't have seen it or weren't up or didn't see it this morning, can you kind of review what you talked about?
Yeah, so I talked about working from first principles and using that to make decisions. First principles are things that you believe in, not for any logical purpose really, but because you think they're right. So for me, one of those is freedom. Freedom as a fundamental principle that we can make decisions having that as a base axiom, really. And so using freedom, you can make decisions about, for instance, what open source license to choose. And I made an argument that public domain is not the solution. It's too legally, there's too much gray area. Things like the WTFPL or the beer license, like buy me a beer the next time you see me if you use my code, are problematic because they're too vague, they're unenforceable, and they end up looking like you have to add something to deal with the warranty issue, which is an implied warranty that you give someone when they use your code. If it breaks or causes harm to their company, they could sue you if you don't release that warranty. And then MIT license, to me, is the best solution to open source code today because it retains and is built off of this idea that I want you to be able to do anything you want with my code as long as you understand that you have to, if you change it, you have to include my copyright license and this license, the MIT license, if you redistribute it, and you accept that the software is as is, which means that you waive all of the warranty claims that you would otherwise have, which protects me legally, so you stay out of trouble. The license is like this long on a sheet of paper. Very easy to understand, and it's built on a basic assumption that you should be able to do anything you want as long as you agree to keep me out of trouble. Right.
So one of the things you brought up, though, that I thought was fascinating, too, was to be able to choose the right license that's right for you. Because the MIT one sounds like the simplest, best, cleanest one. But there might be cases for developers that they need something a little bit different.
Yep.
And how do they choose? I mean, if say they have a project on GitHub, how are they going to choose which license is the right license for their project?
So we now have a license chooser built into GitHub. When you create a repository, if you want to create a blank repository that you're then going to put work into, you can choose a license via picker right there. Now, it has some suggestions, and then it has a longer list. But we've also just released the site called choosealicense.org that you can go to, and it gives you a few recommendations for open source licenses, specifically MIT, Apache, and GPL, that you can then apply to your software, and it gives you reasons why you might want to choose one or the other, right?
So if you're a large... Kind of like patterns, like things that might be mobile or they might have different properties to them, or...
Really, it's more about what rights you want to preserve, right?
Yeah.
So MIT says, basically do anything you want. Use it for commercial, sell it to people, sell it back to me. You don't have to give it to your changes to anyone. To me, it's the maximum amount of freedom that you can give someone in a responsible, licensed, legally sound way. That's the ultimate to me in freedom. Now, the Apache license adds a clause. It's very much like the MIT, but it adds a clause for patents to protect you from patent litigation. This is really important for large companies.
Yep.
So if you're a big company, that might be a better choice for you because the risk is higher as you become a larger company for when you open source. GPL is about a completely different kind of freedom, right? But it requires a bunch of restrictions to guarantee that freedom. So you can go any of those ways. Like, freedom as a base principle is about letting you choose what's best for you and what you think is right. Now, I will evangelize the MIT license because I think it's the best at preserving real freedom for anyone to use your code in any way.
Excellent. Well, you know, I can't wait to see what you guys continue to do with GitHub. I mean, the whole idea of a license chooser and helping people make informed decisions, I think is great. Everything you've done so far has been wonderful with GitHub.
Thanks.
We actually build our tool chain on top of GitHub, so it's changing us.
Yeah, great.
So we look forward to seeing what you guys do in the future.
Thanks so
much. Thank you, Tom.
Appreciate it.